This is going to be a very odd session, so hang on tight. First, just a quick poll. How many people here identify as a programmer? So almost all of you. Anybody identify as a tester? Anyone identify as a manager? Anyone identify as a product owner? All right. So fortunately, this is for all of you. And that's going to become clear after the very first session. Right. So you can play along with this, but we're in a very short session, so I'm going to encourage you to play along with it tomorrow or when you go home. This is independent research, but it turned out to happen sort of in parallel. There's a professor out in Iowa who's using the same technique, but he also uses food, which I will not use on you, to teach penguins or pigeons to diagnose cancer. So he's going to use the same technique. He shows them a lot of slides. And after 15 days, they are 85% successful on diagnosing cancer. And they are birds. So like I said, it doesn't matter if you identify as a programmer or not. This will still work. If it works on pigeons, it will work on you. But as I said also, I first developed this at an open space with someone who knew about birds. I didn't know about the pigeons at the time. And he knew about sparrows. So our very first example we're going to do is with sparrows. It has nothing to do with programming, but this technique is so weird that I find it's really useful to step back and do it with something that has nothing to do with programming whatsoever, so you can kind of get used to the technique. Does that make sense? It probably doesn't. It's going to be okay. There are two really important rules for the exercise we're about to do. And the first one is say the word out loud. You do not have to scream the word. But it is very, very important that you enunciate the word. The part of your brain that I want to talk to is not the conscious part of your brain. I want to talk to the subconscious part. And very specifically, I want to talk to your visual cortex. And it will not activate if you do not say the word out loud. So does that make sense? You're going to say the word out loud. All right. And then the second part is I need you to try. Now, I don't need you to be right. You're not going to be right in the beginning. That's perfectly okay. But it is really, really important that you try to be right, that you try to see patterns, that you try to see things. If you try, your brain will figure it out. There's actually some very interesting research out in Switzerland where they take rats. This is a little bit gross, so hopefully everybody is finished with their lunch. And they cut their spinal column in two places, not all the way through, but enough that they're paralyzed. And they put a whole bunch of drugs in them, and they put some wires in them and pump them through with a bit of electricity, and they put them on a harness on a treadmill, and the rat will walk. But it doesn't walk with the brain. It's just the system's just automatically responding. And they can do this for weeks or months, and it will get the muscles to work, but it will not bring the rat back from paralysis. But if they do the same thing, but instead of turning on the treadmill, they take a piece of chocolate, and it turns out rats really love chocolate, like everybody, and they put the chocolate in front of the rat, and the rat's like, oh, I want the chocolate, oh, I want the chocolate. And the researchers actually encourage the rat, which is kind of cute to see. They're like, come on, go. And then the rat's like, oh, I want the chocolate. And then it will start to generate the forces to move its legs. And if they do that, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, the nerves in the spinal column actually route around the cuts and will reconnect, and they'll gain mobility. Just to resum that up again, the difference between just going through the movements and giving a damn can regrow your spinal column. I'm going to try to grow things in your brain. It's a much easier task. But it's important that you try. Say stuff out loud and try. Everybody got it? All right, let's go. It's easier if I go out of that one. This is the way it's going to work. I'm going to show you pictures of a house sparrow. You're going to say house. Nice job. You'll get a confirmation. I'm going to show you pictures of a song sparrow. You're going to say song. You're going to get a confirmation. Do you got it? Go.
Oh.
Nice. So I'm gonna take you through something really quickly just to show you. So that was house, that was song. Are you ready? Go again. You feel how slow and long that is? It wasn't slow and long when I showed it to you 4 minutes ago. But back then, you were just new people who had never really paid attention to birds at all. Now you are experts on house and song sparrows. And so that feels quite long. At the end of those decks, it had sped up to 3/4 of a second per bird. And you might have noticed that that was more time than you needed, but also you didn't really need the confirmation that you not only knew the answer, but that you knew the answer. That is an amazing thing of the brain, right? We are super, super good at pattern recognition. And in fact, what's going on here is effectively just a regular machine learning training set. The same thing that we would use on AI turns out to also work remarkably well on I. I wanna give you guys a couple more pieces of information just because I like you and I've done something to you right now, so I want to just help you. It turns out there are a lot of house sparrows all around Riga. I've already seen quite a few just in my very short time here. And so I have trained you actually on male house sparrows and male song sparrows. And it turns out in the bird world, males and females look very, very different. So some of you guys will have noticed when we were giving these examples that there were some that looked like this. This is actually a male house sparrow with a female house sparrow. You'll notice it's actually different than a song sparrow, but it's different enough that sometimes you'd be like house and song. And as you'll notice them as you walk around, because it turns out male house sparrows and female house sparrows are together quite a lot, you'll be like, that's not right, but he didn't tell me what it is, right? It took me quite a while when I first figured it out. So just be aware that there are these things called female house sparrows. They look different than male house sparrows. And when you're confused walking around Riga, that's probably why. You'll also notice as you're walking around now, you will see house sparrows. In fact, your brain will say house before your conscious brain can interject and say, shut up. And that's exactly what I want to teach you to do with code for the rest of this session. I want you to get so good at recognizing specific flavors of bad code that you cannot help but notice them. If you are a programmer and you're in the code, we can have much longer conversations about what to do now that you notice it. If you are a manager or a product owner or a tester, well, if you're a manager or a product owner, when you see it as you're walking by somebody's cube, you will just say, don't give me that. And if you're a tester, you will say, that is the place I need to test extra because it obviously has problems. So that was sparrow decks. We're going to go to our very first code smell of clutter. You're already familiar on the way that these decks work. So very, very simple technique here. I'm going to show you some code that is relevant. By the way, this is not going to be good code, bad code. There'll be lots of bad code here, but I'm looking for a very specific smell. So I'm going to show you some code that is relevant. You're going to say relevant out loud. There we go. And you get your confirmation. I'm going to show you some code that is cluttered. You're going to say clutter. I'm going to get your confirmation. Are you ready? Go.
Clutter. Nice.
So the first answer is yes. We're not going to do it again right now. But in the very first time, these decks, unfortunately, take me a very long amount of time to create for 3 minutes of content. So the very first time I ever gave this talk, the decks were not nearly as much as I want. Most of these have about 100 examples and about 200 slides with the things. My first decks had like 30 examples because I just didn't have enough time. And when I gave it at the first time, that exact question was asked, can I do it again? And at that time, the entire audience was looking at me like, And I was like, yeah, let's do it again. And we did it, the exact same deck again. Now, it turns out the pigeons that I showed you also do the same deck. They only have like 75 slides that they do repeatedly over 15 days. And that's how they train, right? So you can do the same deck over and over again, and your brain will get better at the pattern recognition. And in fact, there's a phone version of it that you can do. Are we on time? I'll show you the phone version later. But yes, you can repeat these decks, and you just get better at them. The other thing is, this is a bit like shotgun. Like in the beginning when we were doing the birds, right, it was like you wanted to get it to the right way. But when you're talking about code smells, it's much more important the ones you see than the ones you miss, right? So if there are, say, in a batch of code that you're looking at, say there's like 10 smells and you only see 8 of them, then you fixed 80% of your smells and your code is much, much better for it. So you don't have to worry about being perfect on identifying these. We just need to increase the number of hits that you get. In terms of clutter, I find in industry about 1/3 of code standardly is clutter. So if you're a medium-sized project, you're about 100,000 lines of code, 30,000 of those lines of code are clutter. And while normally I'm not going to talk about how to fix these code smells, clutter is so trivial to fix because all you have to do is delete it. Now, 20,000 lines of code is about the size of the very last Harry Potter book. So 30,000 lines of code is 1.5 of the last Harry Potter books that you are paying your programmers to read through. And it's not nearly as interesting as Harry Potter. But there are other issues. All this stuff is online. You are welcome to take and steal and change whatever you need. I'll give you a second to take those photos. All right. And so clutter really affects the time to find things. I don't know if you guys have this here, but in America we have this game called Where's Waldo? And the idea is to find Waldo, right? He's in here somewhere, right? But he's a little hard to find. So there's a little bit of the clutter removed. That's about 30% of the clutter removed. And you'll notice already it's easier to see, it's more comfortable to look at. But I used to think the idea was like, hey, let's just get all of it down so Waldo was so easy to find. And the problem with that is, if I'm really looking for Waldo, I would just grep for him. Right? So it's not that hard to find when I really want him, but the code wants to talk to you. And so let's talk about patterns in your code. Here's a really, really simple pattern. What is it? Let me remove the clutter for you. What's the pattern? Plus one. Here's an example from real life. This is actually my second day at a company. They had a whole bunch of RDLC reports. RDLC is like a Microsoft reporting thing. It is a thing of evil. And they had all these reports. I have no idea what to do with any of this, but I decide let's grep through to find out which ones are still being used. And the ones that aren't being used, I'm just going to delete. So I go through and I delete what I can. And when I'm done, I'm left with this list. Anything weird about that list? Year specifics is actually not the weird part about the list. What's the weird part? Liabilities. Doesn't have a year specific. So on my second day, I walk up to the accounting department and I say, excuse me, are you having problems with your liabilities reports? And they're like, yeah, how did you know that? And I was like, I think I can fix that for you. So I go back to source control, undelete liabilities 2010, swap it in and redeploy. And I go back up and I'm like, how's it working now? And they're like, this is amazing. I don't know what was in that report. I never actually opened the RDLC file. I am definitely claiming credit for somebody else's work. But it was easy to see as soon as I removed the clutter. And that's generally what we're going to see with clutter. Let's go to another code smell. I'm going to show you code that is short enough. You're going to say short. You want to get your confirmation. I'm going to show you code that is too long. Go.
Show you code that is short enough. You're going to say short.
Short.
I'll show you code that is too long.
Long.
All right. So there's a whole bunch I want to talk about on this. First is, I mentioned that you're going to see sparrows. I am a technical coach, which means when I am working with teams, I sit with the programmers and we program together, usually in a mob format. And often I will say something to the team like, what's the smell in this code? When you're doing refactoring in general, a lot of times it's not a case of I know where I want to go and I'm trying to get there. A lot of times it's a case of this isn't right, let me get to better. And then I'll get to better and better, and eventually I'll be good, but I don't know where I'm going, right? I'm moving away from smells. And so we'll be looking at a piece of code, and I'll say, what is the smell here? And the programmers will look at it, and they're, well, it, I don't really, can you scroll down so we can see the rest of the method? Whereas once we go through this deck, we can actually, see if I can pull this up really quick. Sorry. There we go. As soon as it decides to render. Come on, Adam. There we go. So we'll be in a piece of code here. There we go. And we'll be scrolling through this, trying to get to the other thing. And they'll be like, wow, that was long. What can we do about it? Right? They don't know what to do about it, but they can already see that's too long. And then we can have a conversation. Separate into different methods is a big part of that, yes. Yeah, in fact, there's a sparrow deck we won't do today for how to figure out what pieces to separate. But that journey of learning how to fix code, that's going to take you a long time. But you might find that you can't even start that journey until you develop the sense that the code is bad in the first place, right? And how it's bad. Because you're going to use different strategies to fix different smells. There's a different strategy for a long method. There's a different strategy for a long line. There's a different strategy for a bad name. All of these techniques have different strategies. And there are actually lots of talks out there, and they're good talks, and you should watch those talks, about how to fix problems. But there just isn't that much about how to create the sense of style to realize that the problem is even there. So a lot of times people aren't fixing these problems, not because they don't know how, because they don't even really realize that they're a problem. Let's hold off on that one for right now. By the way, about this time, you're probably feeling a little bit tired. That is because these decks are actually a fair amount of work. They're actually creating new pathways in your brain as we're talking. You can actually see those results in the MRI. If that kind of stuff is exciting to you, it is to me. So I just want to acknowledge that you are probably feeling a little tired. We still have a couple more decks to go, so I'm going to ask you, but it's not that much. It's only 7 more minutes, but we're almost there. Hang in there. Let's do one more, and then let's do it on our phones. I'm not going to get all the decks I was hoping to right now. Let's move straight to duplication. So I'm going to, that is that, did I start? Okay. Oh, no, I'm not showing you an inconsistency deck. Sorry. Let me show you. Okay. Right? There you go. All right. I'm going to show you some code that is distinct. You're going to say distinct. You're going to get your confirmation. I'm going to show you some code with duplication. You're going to say duplicate. All right, ready? Go.
Nice. It is a little bit of brainwashing. All right, so pull out your phones and go to bit.ly/sparrowdex, all one word.
On there, you'll see one of the decks is duplication. You can also do it on your computer, absolutely. If you're on your phone, it works a lot better if you turn your phone sideways. If you're on your computer, there are arrow keys. Those will also work. You can either swipe or you can just click on the sides. Try the duplication one.
The code smell duplication?
Code smell duplication, yeah. And one thing, even though you're working individually and you'll be working at different paces, it still helps if you make a small sound when you do it, because again, triggering your visual cortex will happen if you say the word. I usually say it sort of quietly to myself because I get embarrassed, but actually saying it is important. Duplication. Want you to go through the rest of that on your phone, but I'm going to have to pause you because we are so low on time, and there's one little one that I want to give you just to bring home a point. Let's take a look at this sparrow deck. Pause your phones. Here's some stuff that's well maintained. Say yes.
Yes.
Here's some stuff that's not. Say no.
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 Yes.
No.
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 So if you see any of the stuff that's no in your own code bases, don't accept that. That's the first step, is you're saying that is not acceptable. You now have the ability to see those problems. Use that ability. I think that is all we have. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Llewellyn. We all been coded now.
Yes.
So let's jump to the questions.
Thank you for your talk, but just a slight idea. We are brainwashed, okay, we found the patterns, but this is most of the feeling of the bad code, not the some strategical concept of the bad code. It's most of the feelings.
Yeah, absolutely. So once you can see the bad code, we can have, and these conversations are long as to why these are bad code, what are the pieces of a bad code, and even more importantly, how do we fix the bad code? Right? Those are important conversations. To me, they're really important conversations. But step one is that you can see that it's bad code.
But it can differ.
It can be a difference. The longer, what is the length of the, I don't know, of the method or of the line? We can set that 20 characters is good enough, or maybe 15 or 14.
So what is, you know? So yeah, I think the problem is there isn't one, and one of the reasons these decks are helpful is I don't think there are hard and fast rules. One of the things that I find personally for a paragraph, like a method, is if you were to say the steps of that method as a paragraph of English, how long should that paragraph be? And however long that paragraph should be, that's how long the method should be, right? But I can't define the right length for a paragraph. I know it's not 50, and it's definitely not 1,000, and yet I can easily find 1,000 in a code, right? But to me, it's not as important to lock that down, right? If I can recognize bad code and I'm cleaning up the bad code and I'm moving towards good, things are going to be okay. And the hard and fast rules usually come up across edge cases that break. And when they start to break, they start to crumble. Or I've seen this as well. Sometimes people will avoid, like, okay, so as a company that's using sonar, sonar is a static code analysis. They were very strong about not tripping sonar. So I saw they had an array and it was indexed by the word two, T-W-O. I was like, that's very odd. Why is it two? Well, two was a constant that was defined as the value two. And I'm like, why? Like, why would you do that? And they're like, oh, well, magic numbers aren't appreciated by sonar. I'm like, yes, that's true. Magic numbers are bad, but you've not helped this situation, right? And so a lot of times when metrics become a target, they lose their value. And that's why the rules get, like, they're often played and they're gamed. But if you can teach someone to see something that's bad, then we can start this much longer journey on what does quality actually mean? What does good code actually mean? Right? And this is, again, this is just getting us through the door. We have a very, very long way to walk till we get to those skills.
Okay, thanks.
Lately, I've heard an advice to make your code easy to delete, not easy to maintain. Mm. And because a lot of us are using microservices, we often hopefully write services that have one purpose or limited number of purposes. And once they're done, they're not touched. So where's the boundary between making it pretty?
Well, okay, so first of all, that is a boundary, right? Like, and you say a lot of us. There is definitely a decent amount of people who are making microservices that are small, under 10,000 lines of code. And those are things that can be completely rewritten in about usually 2 to 3 months and replaced and deleted. But there are quite a lot of people who are nowhere near that, right? If you are under that boundary, and it seems that 10,000 is the upper limit of that boundary, right? Somewhere around like 2,000 to 3,000 is a number that we can kind of like keep that system in our head. It's still a fairly big system, but you can understand what are the actual boundaries and things. And if you're not sharing a database, which some services do, that's a very, very bad pattern. But if you are actually independent, then you can actually rewrite and get in there. And that is a really nice way to do things. The boundary, though, is it is independent and small enough that you really can capture the functionality of it. And if you're in that situation, great. I still argue that in the 3 months, if you clean up the code smells, you will go faster. But if you've encapsulated your complexity to under 10,000, that tends to work. It's just that is much rarer than I would like to see.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. We have time for one more question.
I assume you have shown this presentation to a lot of people. Programmers and non-programmers, which group is more open for this technique, programmers or non-programmers?
So which group is more open? So ironically, as long as you're saying the words out loud and trying, it tends to work. And that breaks down a lot less by if you're a programmer or not, and much more by the size of the group. So this sounds weird, but the fact that there are, you know, another 50 people saying stuff is really encouraging to you to say stuff. If I had like an individual, I'm going to have less success with this technique, regardless of which camp they're in. In smaller groups can be harder, right? But individuals are super hard, right? So if I approached one of you at dinner and made you do this while we're in a room of people and you're the only one speaking, you probably won't make it through the deck, right? And that has nothing to do with you being a programmer or not. Once you can see it, then you see it, and you see it whether you're a programmer or not. Whether you continue to do anything about it, that I think programmers tend to do things about it more, but that's probably because they're empowered to do something about it anyways, and they're always looking at the code, right? If that makes sense.
Okay, thank you. We need to do last order of the business, feedback. And let's do it a little bit differently this time. Let's go for this technique called return of time invested. You will show on your hands from 5 till 1. 5 was very good, a lot of value, I like it. 1, quite opposite of the 5, okay? I will count 3, 2, 1, and then everybody shows.
So I just want, before you guys even vote, if you give me like a 1 or a 2, I would invite you to please come and tell me why. I won't, you know, question you or stuff, but it is actually quite nice to hear the feedback so I can improve. I'm constantly adding it. So I just want to invite you to come and give me actual critical feedback. You can talk to me regardless, but I'm going to extra ask for the people who give me low feedback.
Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1, show. Nice feedback. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, that's it.